to go. For those that may not make it out, and you have the opportunity to watch and view, but there's nothing like gathering in person, Father God. So we thank you for that. It lifts you up. And we come together because we never forgot. We never forget. We never forgot what God has done for us, what Jesus has done for us, Father God. Father God, we just want to pray right now for the sick and the shut-in. We want to pray for Gilda Pitts, who is in transition right now. Lord, lift her up unto you, Lord. You had that conversation. And whatever your will is, let it be done. In Jesus' name. Father God, we just ask that you keep Gianna Grayson. Keep her, Lord. She has work to do, Lord. Even at a young age, we have work to do. And we know it's a part of your plan. So, Lord, we just ask that by the end of the day, if you can, if it's your will, we ask that she be released. I'm just asking. I'm just asking. We know you can do all things. You have the power over this world, this dying world. You have the power. Lift her up right now in the name of Jesus. And if there's something that the doctors need to do, give them the power. Be in them. Lord, give them the wisdom. But I just want to believe that she's going to be okay. Brother Earl Murray Sr., Tyrone, keep them lifted up. And whatever their needs are, fulfill those, Lord. Fulfill them for us, Lord. And for the individuals that have birthdays this year, I just want to just say happy birthday and God, lift them up. Give them joy during the time of their celebration. But the real birthday is the day that we were saved. The day that we accepted you, Lord. And that one I really celebrate, November 4th, 1972. Thank you, Jesus. So, Lord, I just ask that you just continue to bless us in our time of need. Bless that word that's going to go forth on today. I pray that it touches someone. That they find you. I pray that it convicts them. That they find you. I pray that it comforts them. And they find you. I pray that they just tap. If they're out in the Facebook audience, that they tap amen and just say, I want to be a part of that. I want to be a part of what you are celebrating about, what you are happy about. I want to be a part of the gifts that you're receiving because God is a wonderful God. He fulfills all our needs and he gives you favor. When you set apart, he gives you favor. You just have to follow him. Understand that he sent that comforter, the Holy Spirit. And when you accept him, he dwells in you. He dwells in you and he leads you and guides you. And there's no mistakes ever made. Lord, just want to continue to pray for the lost. They're wandering in the streets. In this world. And I pray that as we leave out of this building, out beyond these four walls, that you send those individuals to us and we be prepared to give them that word. We be the steward. We be the Bible. We be you that they need to see. And I pray that we give them those words and they can be convicted right then and there. Don't miss the opportunity. Ask them to give their life to the Lord then. Lord, I'm sorry. This is just such a moment of prayer that we just need to honor right now, Lord. If you have a problem because of the pandemic, you can't come physically, but just leave it here at the altar. Send it in the atmosphere to the altar and leave it there. And just believe that it's going to be taken care of. So as I bring this prayer to a close, Lord, I just ask that you continue to bless me in my endeavors and bless any and everyone that may need you. And all these blessings I'm going to ask in your son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Now let us just come forward and have some offertory music. We just want to collectively thank all the givers, particularly the ones using the convenience of the Giveify app. It has been a blessing during these times we've had in the world today. When you go out there and download the app, all you do is search the New Antioch Bible Fellowship. This convenience has been a blessing. And God blesses a cheerful giver.
God, we know it'll be used for the uplifting of thy kingdom and the furtherance of thy gospel. It's in Christ's name we pray with a whole lot of thanksgiving.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Now we're going to take time out to give some birthday shout-outs. I have, for the first today, the birthday is Gabriel Grayson, Doris Hamilton. Happy birthday. And just in the, tomorrow is Robbie Canada. And in 2 days, Ezekiel Grayson. All these Grayson birthdays. Yes. And then we have Seth Lewis this month, Candace Williams, Brian Crump, Paul Madry, Michelle Coleman,
yes.
Teresa Amen. Jones, and Anissa Banks. Hopefully I didn't mess that up. Anissa Banks. All right. Amen. Amen. And then lastly, we have some anniversaries. Larry and Malaysia Pollard. Amen. 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 All right, I have Richard and Christina.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, thank you. Thank you. I failed English. Happy anniversary, everyone.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. That's it. Come back with a praise team.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Sick. sing and shout.
I'm moving on.
Cause when you hear me singing,
I'm moving on.
I've been praising my Lord.
I'm moving on.
You see, I'm moving closer, y'all.
I'm moving on.
I'm moving closer to my heavenly
home. I'm moving on.
About him, and I miss him dearly, and he would fall asleep at 9 o'clock in the morning, and we started at 8. And I said, Jim, you can't go to sleep. The boss will see you. He said, he's seen me sleep before. It's all right. So he kept on, he missed it. So he kept on sleeping, Carla. I found myself now at 10 a.m. I might just fall out on you if you don't keep talking to me. Amen, somebody. But I thank God for another day in the land of the living. Amen. Amen. I want to pause for a moment, and I'd like to thank Judah Praise. Amen. Y'all can put y'all hands together and give them an applause. I'd like to thank God and for our worship leader.
Amen.
Amen. Edwards, Minister Edwards, amen.
Amen.
Mom Ethel leaned over and said, boy, he's ready now. He took the training wheels off, car. He's riding the bike now. ain't falling over, and the wheels ain't falling over either. He's all right now. Amen. But I want to praise God for the media team. Amen. For Hillary Wilson and for Jahari. We thank him for Reverend Steve Stewart, for our finance team in the back. And for, I would be remiss not to look up and I saw Jada White.
Amen.
To Jacob, amen.
Amen.
We are praying for her and with her.
Amen.
Amen. In her healing. And we know God is able.
Amen.
If you don't believe it, just look over there. Amen. You will see that he is able and he has hands that can heal.
Amen.
Amen. But our hearts go out this morning to a few folks. I want to reiterate and re-announce those that are in need of prayer for Earl Murray Sr., for Tyrone Murray, for Gilda Pitts, Larry Powell and the family, and then for Gianna Grayson, who's at Children's Hospital.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So we ask that you would keep them in prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. There is a word from the Lord this morning. You'll stand with me. Amen. We're not going to be long. Amen. I want to lift up from the 24th Psalm from the King James Version. These words, and if you have found it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let me again greet all of you in the name of Jesus. I'm glad to see Mom Sumter is back with us again.
Amen. Amen.
She came in rocking, Carlton.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Glad to see Sharita and everyone that is here this morning. We are so grateful. I don't take any day for granted.
Amen.
Any moment for granted, Skip. Any day and any moment that God gives me above ground. Amen. I'm going to take time and praise him.
Amen.
Because he is faithful.
Yes, he is.
I know times change, people change, circumstances and situations change, but he will be the same.
Yes.
Forever and for all ways we can count on him. From the 24th Psalm, the King James Version, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas, and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands, and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation.
That's right.
This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in.
Amen.
Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is this King of glory. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. One thing before I begin, Jada, that struck me is that I texted her early in the week, Mom Janice, and I said to her we were praying for her and wishing her well, and she responded, I'll be back in church soon. I had no idea it would be today. Amen. So I know God is able, and I'm so grateful and surprised, pleasantly surprised to see you this morning. Amen. Amen, church. Amen. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus and the power of your spirit, we thank you for this day. God, as we go across this list of names that are in the need of prayer, we simply know where we cannot be, you are already there. And you may use us, God, somewhere in the process, in the progress, to speak to them or to hold them or to embrace them. And so we are ready and prepared to do so. We thank you for Jada here this morning, Jada White, God, and the recovery that she is having. In your name, Jesus, we know you're a doctor who's never lost a patient. We thank you for her parents and her siblings as well. And for this congregation, God, we're grateful. For the online congregation, God, bless them as well. And now, Father, we simply ask that you would hide Fields behind your cross. Keep him under the dripping of your blood. Right across his mind and his heart, the words that are found in the gospel, according to John, the 12th chapter, 21st verse. Sir, we would see Jesus. We lift him up today, that someone who is in sin may be rescued. We lift him up today that someone who is backslidden can be reclaimed. And we lift him up today that someone looking for residence, fellowship with the Father or with this church home or any church home, we know, God, you will deliver them. Let your word go forth, unshackled, unchained, unfettered, and that it shall never return unto your void. It will accomplish what you sent it out to do. It's in Jesus' name. And for his sake we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Just as we continue for a brief moment, I want to lift up this series, Who Am I? Understanding the Lord. Who am I? Understanding the Lord. And I know, Dr. Berry, we are in a series, and we have started out talking about stewardship, and we will continue to do so. And one of the things about these words that we're about ready to look at, Stephen, to glean, is how does God get stewardship out of this text? You may not see it now, because I didn't see it immediately, but God will show us why stewardship is in this text and why it's important for us to understand who the Lord is. Amen? So over here, yeah, in the last 4 weeks, Jacob, we have been lifting up in our hearing from our mini-series on stewardship. LP, we started with Who Am I? And so far in this powerful moment, Jacob, we have heard, Skip, from God's words, beginning with Who Am I? Next, the last week we talked, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks, we talked from Who Am I in Him. The following week we talked about Who Am I in Uncertainty. And then last week, Carla, we talked about who am I before and after. And the aim, Jahari, and the goal in this series, Hillary, is to have God's people, through the lens of God's word, discover, display, and demonstrate what it is to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. What is it, Derek, to be a good steward of what God has given us? And the Lord Jesus Christ will help us become better disciples through his word. Jordana, we believe in this moment, church, is for me a hill to die on. What do you mean by that, Pastor? I mean, it's a hill that I believe that we can sacrifice, we can surrender, and we can submit to the truth that God is ready to present to us and go out the door believing that Jesus died for our sins.
Amen.
We believe this moment, let me repeat what I just said, is a hill to die on. Because the body of believers, Jordana, watch this, who has said yes to him may have never been taught, may have never been instructed, and may have never moved from their seat to service, nor have put their heart, their hand, their hands, their help, and their hope to the gospel plow. Mm-hmm. To become good stewards, Mother Sumter, to live for Christ, to labor for Christ, to love for Christ, and to love him and the cause of Christ. So church, this misunderstanding, this misdirection, and this misinformation that has been around for years, Carla, is still prevalent, Henrietta. It's still active and very much still alive to this day, Reverend Stewart, in that this is all about self. That's a lie. It's all about me. That's not the truth. That is about myself. That is wrong, and it's never been about I. I need to make that clear this morning. The departure from the truth, that deviation from the truth, that demolition of the truth, and that disregard for the facts, Jacob, that misrepresentation, church, that mindset and that misleading of truth is a fabrication, a distortion, an error, a falsehood, a misrepresentation, a deception, and is a lie that will be dismissed by lifting up from this text the truth, because Jesus declared, the truth shall set you free, and the truth shall make you free. And whom the Lord has set free is free indeed. So who am I? Understanding the Lord. Here are our definitions for this morning. To interpret for understanding. To interpret in one of a number of possible ways. Knowledge and wisdom put into action. And the ability to comprehend and act in accordance with one's knowledge and one's choices. Here are the biblical definitions of the word understanding. The God-given ability to separate, distinguish, and discern the difference between right, what is right and what is wrong in God's eyes. To perceive the consequences of wrong acts or omissions by learning from the errors of others, not having to learn the hard way. And you can look at Proverbs 13, 15, Proverbs, and then Job 28:28. Amen?
Amen?
Let me go back. Not having to learn the hard way from other people's errors. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Here are the synonyms, Mom Ethel, for the English extraordinary etymologist. Comprehension, apprehension, grasp, grip, perception, discernment, interpretation, cognizance, conception, digestion, assimilation, considerate, compassionate, empathetic, and responsive. Amen? Here are the quotes for this morning. The biggest communication problem is people do not listen to understand. People listen to reply.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Can I give an example, Carlin? Have you ever told someone your problem and they cut you off in mid-sentence and already solved it? That's what number one is about. Amen. Hillary, all these cameras on.
Amen.
We all good? Amen. Amen. Number two, a wise person will hear and increase learning, and a person of understanding will attain wise counsel. Proverbs 1:5. If you think and believe it's expensive to hire a professional, wait until you hire an amateur. Amen. Quote, communication to a relationship is like oxygen without it. It dies. Unquote, Tony Gaskins. The biggest mistake by most human beings, listening half, understanding quarter, and telling double. Yeah, I will. The biggest mistake by most human beings is listening half, that's halfway listening, understanding one quarter of what they're being told, but they go and tell double. Amen. I don't like to write that one either.
Yet.
Amen. My picture is next to that, Jada. Being in a relationship is about learning, understanding, and trusting the other person. And here we are at our takeaways from our text. But first, Janice, Skip, let me give some historicity to the text, and then we will go forward. The 24th Psalm was written by David. David's intent, Dr. Carlton, is writing this psalm was to communicate a song to the King of Glory. The song was to be sung, watch this church on Facebook, watch this. This song, this is an important moment. This song, I gotta repeat it. This song was written or being sung on a procession as the occasion was, it was a celebratory moment. Now picture in your mind, LP, Mom Sumter, it's being sung while they're walking and heading towards the temple. That's gonna be important when we get to the close. It's being sung. But let me qualify it even more so, Reverend Stewart. They're singing on their way to the temple because God has just brought them out of a battle and gave them the victory.
Amen.
All right. All right. And not only that, they're carrying, I wish I had some help, they're carrying the Ark of Covenant, Jacob, which was considered to be the Lord's throne, is considered, Janice, to be his presence. And they're walking. Can you see them walking down Lancaster Avenue, carrying the Ark of the Covenant, which is the Lord's presence, and they're outside the door, LP. Don't let them in yet. They're outside the door, and they're ready to come in to the temple, to the tabernacle. They're bringing the Lord's presence after a battle has just been fought, Carla, and the Lord has given them the victory. I wish I had a church this morning. Steve, here they come. And the 24th Psalm before us this morning follows the beloved, and arguably, watch how this hooks up with the 23rd Psalm. The most read, the most quoted, the most memorized, the most familiarity to the 23rd Psalm known to the history in mankind. Church, most of the saints and even some of the ain'ts in the house know some of the psalm. Well, they know all of the psalm. Everybody in the household of faith, Hillary, have heard, have read for themselves, know how it begins, Henrietta, they know the middle, and they know the end. The 23rd Psalm is often read during funerals, memorials, and at burial locations. But it is the psalm that follows these that has our attention this morning in this 24th Psalm that is associated with and closely follows the thought of Psalm 23. So here we are at our takeaways from the text. The earth is the Lord's, verses 1 and 2. I need you to high five yourself if you just by yourself and say the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Are y'all cut? Y'all stop. Number 2, for he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Amen. Watch this. I had you repeat it because it's the foundation, and this is where the house is going to be built. And Carlton, if the foundation ain't right, I know that ain't grammatically correct. If the foundation, I got some English teacher, if the foundation ain't right or isn't right, I'll do proper. Isn't right, I'm sorry. Ain't right, the house will never be built and it will not stand. So the first takeaway, Jada, watch this, is the earth is the Lord's. Let me say it another way. All the material and all the mankind that is in the earth belongs to the Lord. Yes. Plain enough?
Yes.
Watch this. This affirmation, church, must be accompanied and married with and never be divorced from the believer's heart. Everything belongs to God.
Amen.
It does.
Amen.
It does. Watch this. That's what we have to start, because if we don't understand that and we don't believe that, because there are some folks in the church who don't believe that everything and everybody, anywhere and everywhere, all belongs to God. We got to start there. You got to believe that. You got to own this. You got to walk with it. You got to sleep with it. Everybody and anything belongs to God.
Amen.
Everything. If Mom Brown was here, would she say everything?
That's right. Yep.
Belongs to God. Mm-hmm. He is the creator king. Yes. Henrietta and I have a saying in our house, he is the owner.
Yes.
We say it just like that. He is the owner. Let me say it again for the Holy Ghost. He is the owner. Yes. It all belongs to him and him alone. Jada, he is large and he is in charge. Beside him, there is no other. He is above all, everyone, and everything, and anything else is below him. I know. There's someone possibly here or possibly online, Ralph, or possibly may stop me later on, or who may view this later on YouTube and say, yo, Pastor, wait. You may not believe it, or you may disagree with it, or you may try to dispute it. But all you got to do is turn to Romans 14:11, for it is written, as I live, says God, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that he is God. He is the Lord of all. Carlton, there is no one he has to answer to. Wouldn't that be nice, Jacob? Don't look to your right or left. Just look straight ahead to you. If you didn't have to answer,
everybody
answers to somebody.
That's right.
Amen. If you own your own business, I guarantee you, you still answer to somebody. You may not want to answer or you may not answer, but there's a price to pay. I guess that's just in my house. But everybody answers to somebody. So Mom saying the Lord took me a step further and said, even folks who talk to themselves.
Answer to somebody.
Themselves. Church, he is sovereign.
Yes, he is.
That means he does what he wants to do.
Come on.
J- Jada when he wants to. Skip how he wants to. Georgina where he wants to. And this part healing is with whomever he chooses to. There is nothing nobody can say about it or do anything to stop him from doing so. He is Henrietta the head honcho. He is the big cheese, the big enchilada, the big dada, and the real big papa. All the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. The earth is the Lord's. It all belongs to him. I'm going to say it one more again. He is the owner. How so, preacher? I got some questions. I hear them. How so, pastor? Verse 2 says he found it, Jordina.
Yes.
That means he ordained it upon the seas and established. Skip, he fixed it, he prepared it, and then he applied it upon the rivers. God all by himself. When I read the text, I don't see nobody else's name attached to his. Amen. Steve is all by himself. Jordina, watch this, your heart. Whatever man has invented was from a discovery from the creation by the Creator. Let me go back and say it again, because somebody's smart thinking, you know what, we got people who invented stuff and feel they create. No. They only created from the Creator, which was already here. Okay, that's not deep enough. Then whatever mind power they use, guess who gave them the brain? So nothing that they've done or created is of their own, although they may claim it and have copyright for it. I get all that, but God is still the creator from which they took from his creation and then took something and then discovered it and then began to use it and apply it. Okay. Nobody else's name is attached to it but himself, his lonesome. Nobody else is speaking to his heart. Nobody else is telling him in his ear. Lord have mercy. Stop me for a minute, Elder Barry.
Come on.
Nobody's talking in his ear. You know how you're driving and somebody on the right. You know how you're driving and somebody on the right. They got their own set of brakes, Jada. Somebody got to take me. Skip, you got to take me home. And eyes. Yeah. But there's nobody telling God how to drive the car. Yeah, you and I can identify to a certain degree when God, according to his word, his will, and his way, has told us to carry out his vision and desire. Then here comes somebody else. Amen. There's always, if you're in ministry and you're serving, there's always somebody else in your ear. Amen. Telling you what God told them to tell you. Amen. And you know it's not God's word. It's not his will or his way. Skip, if I might be honest about it, they're just spiritual pygmies with a stunted spiritual rope. And they're stinking thinking, trying to interfere with what God had told you to do.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
All right. And I don't want to dismiss this, Carlton. Watch this. God sometimes will send people to you whom he has spoken to. Through and will always advise you, but simply all you have to do is check the word and try the spirit with the spirit, and then you know God has sent them. If it's something way about flesh, you know God ain't involved in none of that. So he is the owner. And Steve, here's the hookup. Because he is the owner, that means he makes us stewards of what he owns.
Come on.
Okay, I'll get there in a minute. Yeah. If he is the owner, all we are just managers of what he's given us. Our time, our talent, our temple, and our treasure. First of all, he is the owner, and it all belongs to him. All we're doing is just managing what he has given us. That's why verses 1 and 2 is the foundation, because if he's the owner, we're just simply the managers.
Yes.
I feel a little British coming on. We're just here to manage his plan, his purpose, and his promise, only fueled by his power, according to his covenant relationship, to restore mankind back to fellowship for his glory. Now, who am I when I understand the Lord? Here comes number next. I'll hook it all up and tie it in a bow, and we'll be out of here in a minute. Watch this. Not only is the earth the Lord, he is the owner. Watch this. David asked two questions. Who shall ascend? Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? And then he comes back with, oh, who shall stand in his holy place? Watch this. The psalmist, after laying the foundation in verses 1 and 2, now asks two questions with two answers. They are on their way, and I got to keep repeating this because you'll see in the end the hookup, as my friend was saying back home, this is the holy hookup. They are on their way to the temple, Henrietta. Moreover, they're ascending to the hill of the Lord, Georgina. And when they get there, David asks another question, not only who was able to ascend, but who will stand there in his holy place. It is those, Reverend Stewart, who conform themselves to the laws of truth, to honesty, humility, justice, and love of God. And here's the hard part, Henrietta, and God's people. See, we can love God, Mom, something. I know I'm in this class. We can love God all day long, but it's other folks that get on my nerves. Yes. I know I'm talking right. Skip, I got to talk about myself. And the only way, watch this, Janice, for us to stand in the hill of God or to stand in the holy place is that we must be covered by the blood of the Lamb. Amen. We take on the righteousness of Christ when we accept Jesus as our Savior. Jesus is the door we must enter by. I know a lot of folks are talking about a lot of doors, but Jesus is the only way to the Father. There is no other way to him but through Christ Jesus. He is the door caller we must all enter by. Heaven and the most holy place is open to all believers, but it's only because of Jesus' shed blood. So in verse 4, he answers the question, the two questions, he that have clean hands and a pure heart, who have not lifted up their soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. This is a matter, church, of not having sinless perfection. Now, nobody has sinless perfection. All of us fall short of the glory of God. It's not a matter of anybody being perfect. This simply comes down to the integrity of our inward motive in our outward manner. Amen. Let me say that again. I was in an interview, Jacob, years ago, and the prospective employer asked me, he said, Don, how do you define integrity? And I knew if I had took too long to think about it, he would not hire me. So I simply, with the help of the Spirit, said, you know what? It's doing the right thing when no one's looking. He said, you got the job. Amen. I'll call home office and say, you know, all the other interviews, we'll just walk through those, but I'm sending you to Indianapolis to take the job because of your answer. Because on this particular job, I was by myself a lot. And I mean a lot. He may tell you, I carried all through the state, and I covered the whole state of Ohio. I went south to Cincinnati, I went north to Cleveland. I went east, I'm trying to get my directions together, east to Cambridge, and I went west to Dayton or wherever that is, out in that area. I had the whole state, and I was by myself a whole lot of times. And it depended upon me doing the right thing when no one was looking. I'm talking to somebody. Amen. And so when you define integrity, this is a matter of the inward motive and the outward manner. See, I can fool a lot of folks with the outward manner, Jacob. I can get it past some folks, but God knows the heart, and the inward motive is what he is monitoring. And if you look long enough, you'll soon find out that the outward manner will catch up with the inward motive, and you'll find out that I really didn't mean you any good.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Ah, this is heavy, but we got to go through it. Doing the righteous thing, Henrietta, when no one is looking. Notice I didn't say right thing. The righteous thing, which is associated with God. A pure heart and clean hands go together. A pure heart and clean hands go together. Those who are holy in thought, holy in motive, and holy in deed. The holiness, Mom Sumter, in thought, motive, and deed, is possessed by humans, can only come from Jesus' redeeming sacrifice on the cross. This has nothing to do with good works. nothing to do with good works. Why do you say that, Pastor? Because I know what the Bible says. This is not a works lest anyone should boast. But it is a gift and it's the grace of God that we're able to do what we do for him. So in verse 5, as I get along, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Verse 5 speaks to those who receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from God of their salvation. Let me qualify this. It says to us to receive the future for the present. See, I got Janice, I was I won't call it a debate or a fight, because it was unfair, because the person didn't know what they was talking about when it comes to the word blessing. See, a lot of people get it misconstrued. I want to talk to the cameras right now. And a lot of people think blessings are material things. Listen to what I'm about ready to tell you. I got to correct some theology. Yeah, they are in a certain extent. But let me qualify. Watch this, Elder Barrett. Watch this. Watch this, Reverend Stewart. Listen, church. When we call them blessings, God expects us to take what he is giving us that we call a blessing and bless somebody else.
Amen.
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 That's right.
So that means if I take my car and put praise the Lord on the tag, and Jacob, you need a ride, and I'm going to take you around the corner. Our homes that we have, they're to be used for ministry. Yeah. Everything that God gives us is to be used for it. If you want to call it a blessing, I have no problem, Mom Sumter, but make sure you take that blessing. Listen, when the Lord heals you, Jacob, Jada, watch this. The Lord has healed you. Some people say, well, Jada, that's a blessing. It's a blessing when you go and stand in front of somebody who's suffering and dealing with what you dealt with and told them how the Lord brought you through it and took you to Mount Carmel and guided the servant to hand and you tell them now I'm recovering. That's the blessing.
Yeah, that's right. Amen. Amen.
Everything we go through, I learned this a long time ago, Gail, really isn't for us. We may have to go through it, but it's to bless somebody else. See, I would never know what it's like to be strung out on drugs and to lead people to Christ who are strung out on drugs. I've seen it happen. I know what it's never like, Carlton, to not have money. This brother, can I plug a PSA for a moment? I want to toot his horn like that. I've seen him give assignments that God has blessed him with to somebody else so they can start their business. I know about it. That's what we're talking about here. That's what it's about. He could have kept it. You're going to hire somebody, Carla, but it took that. You don't mind putting your business out there, do you? It's already out there. But it's true. Henrietta, you don't sit where you sit and not be able to help folks. Wherever you are on your job, even in school, it's a blessing that God gives you every day to go there and to lead somebody to him. I know I'm right. Elder Marshall, I know you a blessing to the teachers. They may not like what you say sometimes, but it's the word of God. And I know you're strong enough and smart enough to say, so what? Get over it. And they do. But somebody will come back and say, you know what? Thank you for those words. Thank you for that encouragement. Thank you for embracing me. Thank you for equipping me. And thank you for the encouragement. Jada, I'm off script, but God interfered, so I got to keep talking right. So let me go back, and if you have a moment, just turn to Ephesians 1. I want to show you what he means by spiritual blessings. Now that we covered material blessings, here are the spiritual blessings, or a few of them, in Ephesians 1. If your page is not marked up, prick your finger and just start circling it with blood, and you'll know where they are at all times. I'm not just kidding. I'll give you a pen if you need one. But watch this in verse 4. Let me go to verse 3. He said, blessed be the God to speak well of him and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Watch this, Doc Wilson, who have blessed us. Here we go. With all spiritual blessings. Paul qualifies it. In heavenly places. He has chosen us. Hallelujah. Somebody should be shouting. God chose us. Jordana, God chose us. He chose us. Even before we thought he would. Let me ask you something.
Come on,
let me talk right here. You ever been, where I come from, we Jake, we had to make up our own games.
Amen.
They ain't have this, all that electronic stuff y'all got kids got. I'm not against all that, but listen. We had to pick teams. A basketball janitor that had barely had enough air to bounce, but we played basketball. We had milk crates for baskets. We ain't had no rims and nets. And I knew what it was like to stand on the sideline, 80 pounds, and nobody would want to pick me. You're talking about peer pressure. Until I got on the court and could dribble a little bit and then shot from 30 feet and all net. And then they said, oh, Fields can play. Then I got chosen every time. But it's nothing worse than not being chosen by your friends or your peers. Can I address the millennials this morning? No, let me just address the whole church. Because old folks got this problem here with me. The issue is we all just want to be accepted. Everybody wants to be accepted. I don't care who you are, how old you are, even old folks, Jacob, like myself, we want to be accepted. We want to be in the number. We want to be inclusive, included. Leave me out of something and let me find out. I got attitude. You should have said something. You could have invited me. I would have came. Yeah, all of us want to be accepted. Can I move on to LP? It's getting heavy in here. It's getting thick. So he says he's chosen us. He's predestined us. I'm in verse 6 now. He has made us accepted in the beloved. Listen to the us. Abounded towards us. Have made known unto us. According to his good pleasure. He had purpose in himself. We have obtained an inheritance. I'm down in 11. I'm in 12. Watch this. That we should be the praise of his glory. Oh, hallelujah. Who trusted him in Christ Jesus. Listen, Mom Sandy, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit. And this is where I get off the train and start shouting, even if it's moving, with the earnest of his inheritance. Watch verse 14 unto the redemption. Watch this. God calls us purchased possession. We purchased. Somebody thought enough of this wretched fool to purchase my life unto the praise of his glory. Now, if you got yourself all together, that don't mean nothing to you. But when you're struggling like I was, that says something to me that he would still choose me, that I would be his purchased possession. All right, I got to move on. To those who come to God with an honest and true heart, God will give even more blessing, justification, assurance, perseverance, and unwavering hope. These are more blessings and many more. The only way to obtain righteousness and receive these blessings is that one must have their robes washed in the blood of the Lamb. Yeah. This is the generation. Watch this. In verse 6, he says, this is the generation of them that seek him and that seek his face. Jacob, I know you're in the Bible. There your name is, bro. Oh, Jacob, and you... You can talk to me later. Pastor, you silly, I know. Oh, Jacob, and let me educate somebody. The word Selah means just to pause or have reverence over what was just said. So just pause for a moment and allow reverence to take place. This is the generation of those who seek him, who seek his face, the God of Jacob. This is the one who is determined to know God, determined to know his will, determined to please him, and determined to serve him. These are those who understand this generation I'm talking about when they seek his face. See, the generation now, Hillary, and the word church from all these other churches, I can't name any of them, but you know who I'm talking about, are talking about seeking his hand first. And not his face. See, the saints of God know that when I seek his face, his hand will follow. It's called adoration. And adoration, Carla, requires us and desires us, when we seek God's face, Henrietta, we can get up from prayer and know that his hand at some point will follow. So this culture that we're living in now is counter to this preaching and teaching that's taking place in this moment, where we may only hear all the time, God will give you. You can have it, reach up and grab it. Name it, and somebody over here sing it with me. Name it and claim it. Even in some of the songs we hear today that offer false hope, wrong belief, and favor that God doesn't offer in his word, God doesn't offer in his will, and God doesn't offer in his way. But know this, the children who believe him, Carla, who take him at his word, Jada, who believe that he is Jahari and live by faith, are the true believers who will always, I need somebody to help me say always, will always seek his face, because we know his hand will always follow.
Amen.
All right. I gotta catch my breath. The earth is the Lord's. Who shall ascend and stand before the Lord? And here's the last point, and we're going to go. The Lord at the gates and at the doors. Lord, have mercy. But you don't see the train coming. You'll hear it in a minute. Watch this, Jada. He says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. On the end, the gates and the doors are the ones who are responding with, who is this King of glory? The Lord called him strong and mighty. David and them, they fire right back. The Lord mighty in battle. And one more plea. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. They reply one more time. Who is this King of glory? And David and them have the last word, the Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this, Henrietta. So here it is at the seventh verse. The procession of worshipers have arrived outside the temple. Let me go back and repeat it. They have returned, Elder Barry, from battle, but not only returned, Reverend Stewart, they are victorious.
Yeah.
Because the Lord fought their battle and was on their side. They not only have arrived at the gates and the doors, Doc Wilson, they also have the Ark of the Covenant with them. This represents the presence of the Lord. The Shekinah glory of the Lord is on the outside of the temple, and their desire is to take him inside the temple, watch this, Mom Sandy, where he belongs. Jada, because he's on the outside, Sharita, in order for this glorious God, this ginormous God, this great big God, this almighty God, to be brought in, watch this, Jordina, it will take the need of the gates to be lifted up, and it will take the gates that will have to be stretched, and it will take the doors will have to be everlasting. That means they have to forever continue to be the doors to receive the worshipers and the worship of the God they're trying to bring in. Okay. All right, let me find out what it's hitting for. EMJ, the King of glory, watch this, Elder Marshall, shall come in. So God all is dwelling between the cherubim on the mercy seat. There is where his Shekinah glory made its presence. They were bringing in the Ark of the Covenant into the tabernacle, into the temple. At the same time, there's a response from the doors who inquire and the gates who inquire, who is this King of glory? And the procession is on the outside. They will reply, the Lord strong and mighty in battle. In other words, it is Jehovah, the strong and mighty one.
Yeah.
It is God who is strong in himself. It is the Lord who is mighty in his acts. The Lord who is mighty, watch this, especially in battle. Whom ye therefore be glad to receive among you as your defense. In other words, he's telling the gates and the doors, you will gladly have him as your defense because he's never lost a battle. I'm going somewhere, Carla. Here comes the train. It is the King for whom we demand and we're asking that you let him in. And so this is repeated in 9 and 10 on account of the backwardness and the negligence of the churches today. Okay, you won't miss it. Watch what I just said. It's repeated on account of the backwardness and the negligence of churches, and particularly part-time believers, to open up and let Christ in. Here comes, I'm painting the picture, I'm almost done. As well as the importance, watch this, to set forth the greatness and the glory of Christ. Steve, I know you see it. Elder, I know you see it. I know you see it. Carl, I know you all see it now. About to make his entrance. In other words, churches today and some part-time believers have shut Christ out where his presence and his glory, moms up there, ought to be. Skip, I'm so excited, I just can't hide it. I think I'm about to lose my mind, and I think I like it. I'm about to lose control up here. The Lord of hosts, Janice, the divine warrior, the commander in chief, not Joseph R. Biden, this commander in chief. Shout out to him for leading this country the way he is. Hallelujah. I won't get political. This is a powerful moment. Is the King of Glory. He is Jehovah, Lord God Almighty, the Everlasting One, the King of Peace. He is our all in all. So let me close. Let me close. It's not about how Christian one looks from the outside. It's about the personal relationship with God one has on the inside. Here is the application. Carla, here is a 2021 moment that I didn't see in the text until God said, look closer. Jahar, here it is, church. Saints that are live here, saints that are online, and saints that will view later on YouTube. And I want to talk to somebody who's not a believer yet. Here's the application this morning. We live in this text at this very moment.
Amen.
Every part of it. And believers are the ones who are in the previous verses, who have an understanding of the Lord. What's this, Henrietta? Don't miss this. So believers, I'm not talking about churchgoers.
Come on.
I'm talking about believers, like David and them, who have come out of a battle and know the Lord Jada has won the victory. The procession has come to the temple, the tabernacle. But I'm not talking about the brick and the mortar.
Come on.
I'm talking about the folks who are on the outside.
Yes.
And as stewards, here comes Skip, as stewards, we're carrying the presence of God in our lives. And every day there's a temple or a tabernacle that you and I will come in front of. And it's our assignment to ask them to open up their doors and open up their gates and call to, you said it earlier in your prayer, and let the King of Glory come in. They want to know who is this King and who is this King of Glory. We simply tell him he's strong and mighty in battle. So let me call the roll of some folks and temples you and I may come across. These are folks, Jada, who are dealing with pain, problem, pressure, causes, and all sorts of people. These are folks, Jacob, who have trials, tribulations, trouble, tried, tired, tattered, torn, turned, tears. These are temples and tabernacles, Jehari, we face every day. They're worried, they're worrying, they're wrestling, they're wondering, and they're weary. These are the temples and tabernacles. We put the procession of God in front of them, who's in ourselves. They've been stretched. They are straining. They're struggling. They're sick. Their sadness and their sorrow and their sin. I got one more group of folks that I don't want to miss. Listen, these are the folks who have failure, who have flaws, who have flops, who have floundering, faults and frustration and foolishness. I stopped by to tell somebody that right now the procession is coming to your temple and your tabernacle. Who is this King of Glory? Open up your doors. Open up your heart and let this King come in. He is the King of Glory. He is the bright and morning star. He is a friend at midnight. He is a drink of water when you're thirsty. Take your procession to the gates and the doors of the temples of people you, they may even be in your own house. I didn't see all that in the text. But at some point, Skip, it's got to be applicable.
Yes.
I got to apply. See, we can talk about the history all day long and understand what David and them were talking about. But God says in 2021, there are plenty of temples and tabernacles that you are processing by every day.
Yes. Yes.
And you carry the presence of God, not in some Ark of the Covenant mouth or something, but inside your heart. And while they're dealing with all their troubles and all their trials and all their tribulations, and they're being torn and tattered, you simply just ask them, like David is saying, open up your gates. Open up your doors. Can I make it plain? Open up your heart, and the King of Glory shall come in. We understand the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That's heavy, Carla. When we understand the Lord, we're carrying His presence in us. We come across family and folks who are struggling with life. Yeah, they are. Yeah, and we have His glory inside of us. Paul says in Corinthians, He's put this treasure in earthen vessels. That God would think enough of us, Ralph, as mean and wretched and cool as we used to be, would put that treasure inside of us called Jesus. When we come across somebody whose temple and whose tabernacle needs to be opened up, it's just simply their heart we're talking about. And the King of Glory. That's a little bit heavy, ain't it? Yeah, it is. Carl, where you go? Yeah, we know pressure is a privilege.
Amen.
See, if you ain't under no pressure, Lord have mercy, he's my amendment now. Serving Christ is a privilege, but there's also pressure. But you got the power.
Amen.
Yeah, you do. That's our commercial. Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. You got the power to take His presence to the people's heart who's struggling, who don't know Him at all. There's no soul that God is not interested in saving. Don't judge them. Lead them to Him. Let the Spirit do. That's not my assignment anyway. We talked about fish last week. You and I can't clean them. It's too much mess. It's messy. You'll throw up and won't be get the job done. You can't handle it. I can't handle it. But the Holy Spirit can. My assignment is to, and your assignment is, that's why we're stewards over, you see it now, what He has given us. If I have a voice that can light up the microphone like Sandy and Henrietta and Derek and Teresa when she's here, and if I could do what the media team do, and if I could just preach a little bit, if I could count my, whatever it is, all of that is being stewards. But the most important point of stewardship is telling someone about a Savior who died for their sins. God has called us to manage that part. I don't want us to miss it. If we're going to be stewards, and we're called to be stewards, remember, He is the owner. And we are the managers. We manage what He has given us for His glory. It's all about His purpose, His plan, and His promises. That He should have none lost, that everybody come to repentance. Everybody, I don't care if you don't like Him. Get over it. When you've been changed and born again, there's some folks who are not going to like you. Get all the Jesus you got. And if anybody's your friend, you better check your pulse. Something wrong with that. I know I make some people mad. Don't bother me. As long as it's in Jesus' will.
Amen.
It ain't from my flesh. I guarantee you. And if it is, I apologize. I'm big enough skip to do that. You know, I ain't one stuck on, so what you mean? I don't care. I'm in charge here. Can I go over here and say this?
Smart man.
Get over it. Our assignment as stewards for the owner is to manage our time, temple, treasure, all for His glory. To bring somebody to His Son.
Amen.
One of the things Henry read, and I'm done. Somebody said, we can go home early. You're right.
Amen.
When preachers tell you they're done, that means about another half hour. I'm just kidding. Watch this, Jada. She read to me her devotion early in the week last week, which was a powerful moment. That's why devotions are important. Not because she's doing, but I'm praying all of us have time, whenever you just do devotions, find a word from the Lord. And she said that today's word was obedience. That right there will preach by itself.
Amen.
Obedience. Everything else, Skip, that we do, unless we're obedient, doesn't matter to God.
Amen.
I can slob all over the mic, and believe me, if y'all see this podium, this I've been slobbing up here. That's why we have wipes and stuff, Jay. I don't want to gross you out, but we wipe off mic, we slobber. But all that slobber don't mean nothing if we're not obedient to His will,
Amen.
To His word, to His way. It doesn't mean nothing to Him. In fact, Satan said, you can go on, carry on. He back in the chair sitting there applauding. He might not be applauding. Yeah, preach on, Pastor. But when you step out that door, you mine.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
1201, I can't flip the switch and go back to the world.
Mm-hmm.
Spiritual for 2 hours, an hour and 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Janice, I stopped at math on trigonometry. Okay, let me see. That's 120 minutes, I believe. 2 hours. The switch has got to be on. And we're going to have moments where we get down. I get all that. But baby, get back up.
Yeah.
You're a steward. You're a steward. Steve, you ain't got nowhere to go. You're Steve Stewart. Your very name says manager.
Amen.
I can cheer with you. That's my son. But we're stewards.
Amen.
He is the owner.
Yes,
and we're managing what He has given us.
Yeah.
And the assignment from this text in the Old Testament, I like the words, the earth is the Lord and the fullness of it, and all of them, the whole world is all there. Gail, I can quote that going on and moonwalk backwards if I want to. But the rest of the text tells me all of this story is about, you know what? We got to take His presence to the temple and tabernacles outside who don't know Him. That's the stewardship that really, when you want to hear, well done, thy good and faithful servant.
Come on, come on.
Satan can stay here and preach a sermon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He can sing on a microphone. He can manage the media team.
Yep.
He can come sit in the pew and give tithes.
Yeah.
As long as you don't walk in His word,
mm-hmm.
you use okay.
Yeah.
But the moment you do, see, He don't bother folks, man, I gotta go. He don't bother folks who ain't obedient.
Right.
They're already on His side.
Yeah.
And really, He don't have a side. Because once He pulled people away from God, He walks away and leaves them.
Yes.
I know I'm talking to somebody.
That's right.
So I want to talk to the temple and the tabernacles that are maybe in this room or maybe in the camera. And a list of name things that I gave, and you're dealing with it, and you've been struggling, watch this, by yourself. I've come to your tabernacle, your temple this morning, to ask you to open up your gate and open up your doors, and I just want to let Jesus walk into your life.
Yes.
If you'll accept Him, and you'll have Him.
Yes.
See, the whole premise of the text call is that it's on their side of the door.
Mm-hmm.
You ever see the painting of Jesus on the other side of the door?
Mm-hmm.
Behold, I stand at the door and knock. There's no handle on His side. The handle's on the outside. We have to let Him in.
Yeah.
And so wherever you go, now that you know, being a good steward,
mm-hmm.
amen, somebody, is taking His presence to those temples in their tabernacle.
Yes.
Amen.
You and I have been through worry. We've been through war. We've been through struggle. Watch what I'm saying. Listen, put it this way. We've been through a battle.
Yes.
We have been, that's past tense. And I feel like Elton John, I'm still standing. Bigger than I. Y'all know Elton John? Okay, my bad. But we've been through something, and the Lord has brought us through. And His presence is still with you. There's some folks who haven't gone through yet. The Grayson family is down at Children's Hospital. LP and them have relative who is transitioning. He don't mind me sharing. We lost a loved one last week. They buried her last Saturday. That family is. We need to bring Him to their temple and their tabernacle.
Amen.
That the Lord will comfort you.
Yes.
That the doctor Jesus will hear you. Jada, you have a testimony now.
Amen.
Not that you didn't before, but now you can show them a scar.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I don't suggest doing that, but you, yeah. You know what I'm talking about. Let me say something. I got, this is it right here. Jesus, this is worth listening to. Jesus is the only doctor, the only physician who has performed heart surgery and never left a scar. Doctor I know who has performed this successfully, and there is no scar. I'm out of time, but not talking. Father, as we stand, Facebook family, online congregation, we come this morning to bring the presence of the Lord. We're carrying him with us. Yes. We're at your temple and your tabernacle. And if you've never said yes to Jesus, we just want you to lift up your gate. Open up your door, which is your heart. Yes. And the King of Glory, he's not going to hesitate. He's not going to tiptoe. He's not going to walk around the corner and come back. He shall come in. Yes. And he'll deliver you. Yes. He'll set you free. Yes. He'll cause your worrying and warning us to be a winner. You can go from victim to victorious. You can go from crush to crown. Just let him in. Let him have your sin. Do the unfair exchange. He'll give you his grace and his mercy. Just give him your sin. He'll take all of it. And anyone who's in Christ Jesus, there is no condemnation. Romans 8:1 says that. You won't be judged. He's paid the price. Somebody is backslidden. Pastor, preacher, can I come back? Yes. 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 Just do the 180 and leave where you're at and what you're in, or whoever's causing you the grief, the pain and the problem. Don't stay there. Come to the promise of Jesus Christ. Somebody looking for residence in a church home with God, he's available. We solicit him to you. We're bringing his presence to your tabernacle and your temple this morning, this hour. You just got to lift up your gate. Oh, ye be lifted up your doors, and the King of Glory shall come in. Father, we thank you now what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard. All those we've been praying for, God, continue to bless them. Continue to be with us as your people, God. We promise to take your presence with us, that when we come before a temple or the tabernacle, where you want to reside, where you belong, in their heart, we'll be a witness. Watch this. A good steward. Managing our time, our talents, our temple, and our treasure, all for your glory. That you will continue to triumph and be victorious in your people. Now unto him who was able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before his throne with exceeding joy. To him, the only wise Savior, our God, majesty, dominion, power, now and forevermore, and all the saints who understand the Lord, together we say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Have a great week.